Professor Ioan Sporea from Timișoara in Romania, and he has such a huge experience in how to perform shearwave elastography in daily practice, and we very much appreciate that you present all your experience to the audience to give us tips and tricks and to give us all that information how to perform shearwave elastography according to the EFSOM guidelines and also to your personal experience. Warm welcome, Ioan, good to see you.
Thank you, Christoph. Good afternoon for everyone, everybody. My task is today to present something between shearwaves and strain elastography, and this how to perform this. We introduced many years ago this elastography, tissue elastography, that can help the clinician in our daily activity to see the severity of some diseases. And mainly to have in mind before Giovanna will speak us about technical information, that strain elastography is a qualitative specialty and shearwave elastography is a quantitative one, and both look to the stiff of the tissue. Now I make a clinical classification saying so of ultrasound-based elastography. We have two types of liver elastography from the point of view of ultrasound. First is shearwave elastography, SWE, and second is strain elastography. Now looking in shearwave elastography, we have three main groups. First one is transient elastography. I will speak about this. Second is point wave shear elastography. First one was VTQ, then later one ELASTPQ, and now other company have inside, or many major company have inside, this point shear elastography. And third one is real-time shear elastography, so-called 2D or 3D shear wave elastography. First came in this family was supersonic image, SSIU, then their system in general, like Toshiba, Philips, Mindray, and other. These have this main type. Second, I will speak very few words to the end about strain elastography. First was the high RTE. Okay, now strain versus SWE. Especially the strain elastography is used in our daily practice, medical practice, ultrasound practice for breast nodule evaluation and maybe for thyroid and other organ, and then can be ligaments or tendons and others. While shearwave elastography is used mainly for the liver, and I will focus especially on this SWE. Shearwave elastography is a very simple one. Why? Because the probe produces shear waves. We don't need to have to make any pressure. Usually we find the liver, we put a box, and then we push a button, and we have the results very quick, expressed in kilopascal for fibroscan or a meter per second, or in both now for quite all the machine. The learning curve for evaluation with this shearwave elastography is very short. Usually 50 examination, it's quite enough to have some experience. But for 2D SWE, some ultrasound experience is necessary to perform good quality examination, how some paper shown. Then how to perform, because this was the question, shearwave elastography. Transient elastography is a blind from the point of view of ultrasound. It's easy to be performed. And I told that at least 50 examination are enough for start your experience to be trained. Point, share with, it's easy to be performed. We must search the liver by ultrasound to find a good image of the liver. Then on this on intercostal approach, and then we put a box, usually 1 centimeter or more than below the capsule of the liver, and we push the button and we have the result expressed in unit. For 2D SWE, it's a little more complex elastographic method because we must have some experience. We must have a very, very, very good image in ultrasound, and there we put our boxes and we try to obtain a very homogeneous color there. Then is this point from VTQ, very simple, the liver intercostal approach between the ribs. Then we can see very well the liver. We can see now here the capsule. We must know with the capsule. We put this box 1 centimeter below the capsule, and then we avoid the vessel, and we know that we are quite in good position. This is to the SWV. This is from Explorer system. Then we have here a very good view of the liver. We put a big box. We try to have a very homogeneous color, blue here, and inside we place a ROI or a circle here, and then we have here the value in kilopascal. That's a bit different between two. First one, point is simple, a box, a number. There we have massive homogeneous color. Inside this color we put a ROI, and then we obtain a numeric value. Now we're looking to our last EFSUM guideline recommendation about liver ultrasound elastographic measurement that was updated this year. I will answer to some question about how to perform. And then recommendation number 3 is that the measurement will be performed through the right intercostal space in supine position. And for this, we need to have during a breath holding, avoiding deep inspiration. Thomas told you previously, then deep inspiration will increase the liver stiffness. That it's a normal respiration. We say to the patient, stop breathing. And in this moment, we push the button to obtain value. Okay, then recommendation 4 is need to have some experience. Then it's will be performed by experienced operator. And I define saying so, experienced operator for transient elastography more than 50 to be trained, but to be experienced maybe more than 500 examination transient elastography is necessary. Recommendation 5, point to the SWE should be performed at least 10 millimeters below the liver capsule. No near to the capsule, because we have modified value, increased value. That at least, but we can go deeper than 10 millimeters, at least 10 millimeters is mandatory. Recommendation 6, it's about fasting. Thomas spoke about this, minimum 2 hours, and you can have 3 or 4 or during the night fasting, but at least 2 hours, and no physical activity for at least 10 minutes before the measurement, because both can increase the value. Then recommendation 11, it's about the image that we must have in point and to the SWE. Must have a good image, adequate image of the liver before placing the box inside the liver. Otherwise, if we have shadow from the ribs, if we have bad quality image in standard ultrasound, we are not able to obtain correct value from liver stiffness. Recommendation 15, to have the good results, a reliable measurement, allow variability, usually we will place the box to a deep 4-5 centimeters from the skin or from the transducer. Then we can see quite well with the skin or the surface of the transducer. We can measure them to have 4 or 5 centimeters from the skin, or to have more than 1 centimeter below the capsule. Something about different method. First one, the oldest is transient elastography, and this is made using a FibroScan, and this is a clinical method for more than 10 years. Now there are many papers published, more than 1,500 papers about this. Now it's a validated method for liver stiffness evaluation. And there are thousands of scientific papers showing the accuracy in comparison with the liver biopsy in ACV, ABV, NAFLD, NASH, ASH, other hepatopathy, and Thomas present this cutoff value and the results from the literature. And now about the transient elastography, we have the guideline. We have two guidelines. One is ESEL guideline on non-invasive evaluation, and the other is for ACV, and both recommend to use this method for evaluation of the severity of fibrosis. Then we have our guideline from the field of hepatology. But we have some problem with transient elastography. It's difficult to be performed in obese patient, despite to use both probe, M and XL. XL is the probe for obese patient. It's not feasible in patient with ascites. There we are not able. We know that we don't use this for ascitic patient. And still the maintenance of the probe is still high. Then you must pay some money for calibration of the probe one or two times during the year. Now I will pass to the second type or third type of SWE method, and we have via point and 2D shear elastography. The advantage for the point and 2D SWE is that this elastographic module are integrated inside an ultrasound machine, and we can use this machine to make standard ultrasound, Doppler or contrast ultrasound. And we can use this elastographic method in a ascites patient, because there was a question about this. Yes, if it's ascites, we must have point or 2D SWE to make this evaluation. And results show a good feasibility and reproducibility of this point and 2D, and quite zero or low cost of maintenance, because calibration of the probe is not necessary. Now it's difficult to decide if we like to buy a machine, what to buy, a point or to the SWE. In our department, we have many system, point and 2D, and every day we look how difficult, how easy it is to perform this. For point, is a very simple method, quick and easy to perform. The ultrasound experience is necessary, but not very high. Find good beaver, then put the box, push the button, having results. The result is a numeric one. It's expressed in meter per second, usually the American model, or in Europe we use usually in kilopascal. And we have some qualitative criteria to know how good is the acquisition. And for this we use a parameter that is IQR, that interquartile range on median, and this must be below 30, like in transient elastography, to have a qualitative measurement. For 2D, SWE is a color-coded and numeric method, have some criteria of quality, to have homogeneous color where we put our ROI. We have again IQR on M, and some experience in ultrasound is necessary, usually maybe saying 300 examination of the liver to find a good image of the liver to put our elastographic box. We have here a point again on the left. Here is from the VTQ system, very simple box. Other system from Philips, we put the box here. It's the same in Samsung, in other machine, very simple method. This we have 2D, this is from supersonic. We must have an homogeneous color. We know from homogeneous color, and looking the scale, visual inspection is no fibrosis, and the value show a good normal value. Here we have a visual inspection. We are somewhere in the middle of the scale. We know that we have fibrosis. And finally, the value is 20 kilopascal. Then we have cirrhosis here. Then from the inspection, color, and then from the numeric, very objective value. Now in this moment, we have behind us a lot of information about other methods outside transient elastography. Then we have meta-analysis, last multicentric study, that showed the non-inferiority of point or 2D for the fibrosis assessment in chronic hepatopathy. For virtual touch quantification, we have two meta-analyses. You can have via the ELSTOGRAPHY. For 2D, we have a large study that was just published this year, looking to more than 1,300 patients, and there are three meta-analyses that compare 2D with transient elastography. And for the other system, a lot of paper appear every week about value for different pathological condition, and about the cutoff, not all the machine have cutoff value for all the pathological condition. Something about strain. Strain was used in practice with some experience for more than 10 years, and initially it was necessary to have some manual compression that was subjective. Later on was more objective, have a coding of the pressure that you put to be green there. Now it's not necessary to have a compression to excitation of the tissue, and it's used heart beating to compress the tissue for elastographic information. But here the results, European results for the liver sieving assessment that was published, Friedrich Roos and Giovanna Ferraioli, two different studies, was not very good results. Some good results come from Japanese study about this method. Then for this linear probe it's used, this linear probe give this image on the screen, and then from this image it's extracted a number of parameters, an histogram and parameter, 9 or 11 parameter, and from this parameter different score, semi-quantitative score was proposed. German elastography score was the first one, Japanese RAS score, and later on liver fibrosis index was proposed. And now the liver fibrosis index is only recommended by manufacturer, but in our guideline that was published this year, have some recommendation about this strain elastography, is that this method currently is not recommended in clinical practice because the results are not enough strong for give us the right to use for clinical use. Now it's other question, how many elastographic method to have? For transient elastography, we know that it's a validated method and is proposed by ESL, European Society for the Study guideline. But in my opinion, it is the opinion of the expert from ELSUM guideline. In this moment, the scientific paper behind the point and 2D, it's enough strong for the introduction of that elastographic method in our clinical practice in hepatology. And like very simple and very clear conclusion, Sharewave is a recommended elastographic method for Sydney assessment. This recommendation comes from EPSUB and guideline from this year. Then elastography is not ready for clinical use, and we invite you to look to the EPSUB guideline to have a lot of information about this elastographic method. And you have here the guideline and the author of this guideline and where it was published online in this moment. And the last one, I like to give you say, a present. It's an ebook that we published in Timișoara about liver elastography, about all the type of and combining our experience with the data of the literature. And you can download for free this ebook, more than 150 pages about liver elastography with a lot of image and information, scientific information. Thank you very much.
Yeah, one more time, dear Johan, thank you so much for your excellent presentation that was really practical and showed all the advances and different techniques of elastography. That was great to hear, and I'm very happy that you showed all that level of evidence and grade of recommendation and the consensus of the contributor to our EFSUM guidelines. Thank you so much. So there are a few questions. How do you measure stiffness in 2D shear wave ROIs of supersonic technology when there are too many colors reflecting difficulties, eventually difficulties in accurate measurement? So there's heterogeneous colors. Could you comment on that?
Yes, usually we have our first visual impression. When it's blue, we know that it's not fibrosis, because it's blue, it means no fibrosis in the SSI system. Then we have a mixture of color, especially going to yellow or orange or something, we know that it's fibrosis there. Then we try to find the most homogeneous color. Don't have very thick blue or something where it's a most mixed color. There we put our ROI. And this is valid for all 2D system, not only SSI.
So we have that ROI and the image and heterogeneous image. Do you select by your eyes, eye-catching features, the best region, or do you follow the instructions of the manufacturer? How do you analyze, it's a second question, a heterogeneous image? You select a part of it, the whole image, you look for your personal experience or more statistical one?
Usually our box, our large box is something 3 on 2 centimeter. Then in this large box we put the ROI. That is approximate. We can arrange usually 1 centimeter size. Then we can put in the same area, colored area, 3, 4, 5 times our ROI. Then we can have in one stop image 3, 4, 5 value. Then we use qualitative criteria to know how good is our image. And now quite all the system, for example Toshiba now, or Philips, they have confidence map showing how confident we can be in the obtained image. Was clear?
Yeah. Thank you so much. Next question. What is the best time to perform shear wave elastography measurements in viral hepatitis C after treatment? So which period after treatment you would recommend to make such measurements?
We have some paper on these topics for Ljubljana. And from my point of view, I believe is not the best moment, is not to the end of treatment. We can use this moment to follow the evaluation of the fibrosis. Then we have value before, 14 saying before, or 15. Then we give the treatment. During 12 weeks of treatment, disappear the inflammation. And then to the end of treatment, this will be, from my point of view, the moment to follow the fibrosis, 6 months, 1 year later, because if we take like starting point before, we have a mixture of fibrosis and inflammation. But after the treatment, when the inflammation disappears, we have pure fibrosis, then we can follow, hoping to decrease the fibrosis. Then probably to the end of treatment is the best moment to start the follow-up.
Thank you so much. So the next question will be to all of you, and the first to raise a finger will get the possibility to answer. We will talk about liver transplantation. Is it a good method, shear wave elastography, to evaluate rejection or study fibrosis in viral recurrence? So we talk about post-liver transplantation, and we think about the measurement. There are different factors. What is the clinical value in the post-transplant patient? More the viral recurrence or more the rejection, or what kind of features we might answer by shear wave elastography? Johan.
If I don't have experience or personal experience, I'm from the literature, we can use the published paperwork for transient elastography to follow the fibrosis. This is the main purpose, an untreated patient. This is historical paper because in this moment we have very good drug to stop the infection, reinfection of the graphon. Then this is for transient elastography for to follow the fibrosis during the time. This is the published paper about this topic.
Next question could come from myself, and it's about chronic virus hepatitis B and C, but not in adult patients, but in children. Are the values we published so far available also for the pediatric patients? So what we have to take care, and do we have enough data for children and chronic virus hepatitis B and C?
The data that are available from the literature so far are very few. So we have to wait before recommending cutoff values. However, in children, it has been shown that in children over 6 years of age, the values are almost similar in a normal subject to the values obtained in adults. So maybe we can use the same cutoffs, but are still waiting for more literature.
Okay, thank you so much. Next question is about how many measurements, and if I might add that information, we could think about the acquiescence technology, we transient elastography, point shear wave elastography, 2D shear wave elastography. Do we use the same amount of measurements, or according to EFSOM guidelines, are there different recommendations on that?
We use I'm answering the question. We use
Measurements.
With 10 measurements for point shear wave elastography and 3 measurements for 2-dimensional shear wave elastography.
Thank you so much. Very precise according to our guidelines. Johan, any comment?
Probably 4.5 are enough. We made some research showing then and we made for 2D2 and decreasing the number of measurements. For practice, for research, you use 10, but in daily practice, 4.5 are enough, and for 2D, again, how Giovanna told, 3 measurements usual probably are enough.
Is it accepted to have high interquartile ranges, median values in patients with liver cirrhosis compared to healthy subjects?
Again, the question, it is possible or it's the explanation?
Is it typical? Is it typical? Yes, it is.
Yes.
What is the criteria for good response after antiviral treatment?
May I answer to this, because we have experience here. We look for a cohort of approximately 250 patients before treatment, cirrhotic patient, and after the treatment, and in 60% of them the value of elastographic measurement in transient elastography decreased with more than 10% of the initial value. From 26 and more than 2 kilopascal is decreasing. For 20% of them, the stiff of the liver room remained the same, and for 20 was worsening, saying so. This is the clinical result from our experience. But how I told in my presentation, I believe that a good moment to follow the decrease of the fibrosis during time maybe is to take like a point or starting of evaluation the value from the end of the treatment in the SVR patient when the inflammation disappeared and we hope or we believe we have pure fibrosis to be followed.
The next comment I loved most, it is about let us pray when we try third to get Giovanna on the screen. So happy for that comment. And then can you repeat my question for Giovanna about measurements in a complex box? If I understand right, we were discussing in the beginning about a heterogeneous Roy, and it was specific a question to Giovanna, if you could discuss this.
Yes. Usually when performing a two-dimensional shear wave elastography, the is more difficult, of course, respect to point shear wave elastography, and the patients should held the breath for at least 5-6 seconds, and a movie should be acquired. And then it's important to look at the stability of the color inside the sample box. Usually in an heterogeneous, when there's an heterogeneity of color, the measurements are performed in the area that is mostly reproducible over time. That is the same at least in 3-4 frames.
There
and,
was.
We prefer not to enlarge the area of measurements, including also the upper part of the sample box, because in the upper part of the sample box, in more than in 50% of the cases, there are artifacts. Artifacts could be seen in the upper part laterally or sometimes down in the sample box.
Thank you so much. Elastography in spleen, is there any relation to portal hypertension? We learned in the liver, the higher the values, the more complications of liver cirrhosis. What can we learn from the values in the spleen? Who likes to answer?
May I answer? We have experience, we published paper in VTQ. We try to find what is better to use, the value in the liver or the value in spleen. Probably the answer is to combine. To combine, Simona Botta proposed a formula in which put the stiff of the spleen, stiff of the liver, and other parameters like presence of the ascites, giving a formula that increased the accuracy of the evaluation of the portal hypertension. Then, sure, spleen is a good, stiff of the spleen, good criteria for portal hypertension. What is difficult, we don't know exactly very clear how to measure in spleen. Last year in Leipzig, in Euroson meeting, was a very nice presentation from Germany showing the variability of the results looking to the place we put our box. In upper, lower pole, in the middle of the spleen, then it's difficult to know exactly. But the value, the cutoff value for cirrhosis we had for VTQ 1.8 kilometer for meter per second for liver stiffness for cirrhosis, and for spleen was 2.4 or something like this. Then the stiff of the of stiffness of the spleen. Is higher than the value in the liver.
About biliary atresia in the newborn. Do you have personal experience in the jaundiced newborn in biliary atresia? Is it more reliable after 30 days old? Any experience about that newborns?
Not me.
Not me too.
What about the neonatal brain? There's one question about, has anyone of you experienced, not in the neonatal liver, but brain? Very exciting, because you have that bleeding, and I love all that questions, but I'm very sorry we cannot answer. But we will learn about that, and it's very exciting to do so. A very specific question. In supersonic version 8.5, there is no quality factor, but we have a standard deviation in each measurement. Are there any upper limits of standard deviation to be accepted?
Not from my point of view. The stability index is not a standard deviation, but is mainly focused on the breathing of the patient, so the stability of the image over time. In a very stiff liver and in a heterogeneous liver, the standard deviation, if we increase the area of measurements, of course the standard deviation increases. But this is normal, and we could not say that is a quality factor.
When using VTQ, how many measurements should be done, and should the point of measurement be different each time or the same? How can we be sure that the measurements are correct technically?
In the same point for 10 times. This is the same for all the point shear-wave elastography method, and we have this recommendation in the guidelines.
In the presentation, there was that FibroScan scale for different diseases, and the question is, are there any scales, as in FibroScan, in order to distinguish different pathologies?
So, my intention when showing this scale was to emphasize everybody that such manufacturer recommendations should not be followed, because they suggest a precision of the methods which is not present in reality. So be very careful with such scales from the manufacturer. Please adhere to the guidelines from FSUMP and EASL, and be aware of the fact that only advanced fibrosis and cirrhosis can be staged accurately, but not different stages of fibrosis.
Thank you so much.
Giovanna, please, Giovanna.
Yes, I would like to underline that when we use elastography, we are assessing the stiffness of the liver that is related to liver fibrosis, but it's not fibrosis itself. And we are using a method that is completely different to the histology. In the histology, we have a categorical scale, and instead using elastography, we have numbers. And there's a continuous increase of number, increasing the stiffness of the liver. So there could be an overlap between stages, and in different etiology of liver disease, of course, we have different cutoffs, but the cutoffs alone should be looked at, also taking into account sensitivity, specificity, and the power to ruling in and to ruling out the disease.
Thank you so much.
Theoretically, we have more information with elastography respect to the storage.
So you are a very short comment.
May I add something only? Is the fact that American Kiba give us a scale for at least 4 systems with some orientative value for different degree of fibrosis. And second, it's about then the accuracy of elastography is increasing, because I don't believe we told this increase with fibrosis being around 0.9 for cirrhosis, but maybe around 0.75 or 0.8 for mild fibrosis.
Thank you. Three more questions. How useful is shear wave elastography in focal liver lesions?
I can answer very short. Look in the ebook that I propose you, because you have the 15 pages about this, not very proof practical value in this moment.
All focal liver lesions are on a regular way stiffer than the surrounding liver tissue. And okay, very good. If doing multiple ROIs in a big sample box, should the ROI be aligned horizontal or vertical?
I do not suggest to use a multiple ROI in a two-dimensional shear wave elastography on a frozen image. This is my opinion. My opinion is that if there was a mistake, performing this particular measurements, we multiply the mistakes. Instead, it's better to take another measurements, another ROI, and so on, till reaching the three recommended for two-dimensional shear wave elastography.
In your practice, how is the reliability of the liver elastography results in obese patients with NASH?
I cannot answer these questions because maybe
Thomas.
I think in generally it's lower than in non-obese patients, because we often see that there is a high shear wave velocity or a high liver stiffness measured by FibroScan, although patients have low fibrosis or no fibrosis. This might be caused by the high skin to liver capsular distance and the underlying fat tissue, and maybe also influenced by the measuring depth or by NASH or steatosis, which is also present.
So the very last question, and is a patient position really important to do the shear wave elastography measurements in FibroScan?
Yes, the position, you mean the supine position?
It seems to be, yeah.
Yeah, but not only the supine position. We're using elastography, transient elastography, point shear wave elastography, or two-dimensional. We are performing measurements in the intercostal space, so it's important to increase the width of the intercostal space, and it's for that reason that we recommend to raise the end. The position should be supine, because in the lateral position at 90 degrees, the pressure inside the liver is different, so the stiffness may vary.
Giovanna, Johan, Thomas, great performance. That was amazing. And looking for the statistics of the audience, we did not lose anyone during our discussion. So people were very eager to discuss, and we had a very fruitful discussion of important questions, and you answered so nicely and so easy with all your experience. I love it.